Olivia, thanks so much for coming. So we only have 3 hours with a break. And I have 38 years of my life experience that I can draw on. So I'm going to try to hit on some key points and hopefully stimulate your thought process and come away with some tools that will really help you in terms of not only thinking about the issues of trance and unethical trance and ethical influence and unethical influence, but also perhaps not make assumptions about people and how they present themselves to you. If they're coming in for a depression issue or a panic disorder or eating disorder or any other type of disorder, because most of the time they won't say, I was in a cult. There's still a lot of shame, there's still a lot of stigma, and that's part of what I've been trying to do with my work, is to stand up and say, yes, I was in a cult, and no, I'm not stupid, and yes, I come from a good loving family, and yes, I was highly educated, and I was caught in a vulnerable moment, and I was deceived and manipulated and indoctrinated, and because it happened to me, which is such an unbelievable thing for my family and friends, like I was the most independent person, it just propelled me into wanting to share what I've learned. And much of the first few years after I got out, with the help of my family, was just trying to do healing for myself, to understand how I came to be so estranged from my own identity and my beliefs and my values. I would like to mention that I was the youngest of 3 children. I have 2 older sisters, middle class family in Queens, New York, conservative Jewish upbringing. I was an introvert. I was a creative writing major in college. I wanted to be an English professor and write for a living and teach. And I was not looking to join the Moonies. The Moonies recruited me. And I certainly was not interested in becoming a fanatical person who slept 3 to 4 hours a night and worked 7 days a week for no pay, recruiting and indoctrinating other people, doing political activities for the cult in the United States. And Dr. Sugarman asked me about, what about Al-Qaeda? And I was like, there, but the grace of God go I could have flown a plane into the World Trade Center or put on a suicide bomb vest. That's how far indoctrinated I was. In fact, I was pretty much told in 1974 that if North Korea invaded South Korea, us Americans would be put on the front lines to die so that America would protect South Korea against North Korea. And you know, that was already a given. And yes, indeed. So there are religious cults, political cults, therapy cults, business cults, large group awareness training cults, cults of personality, multi-level marketing cults. And in the religious cult arena, there are Islamic cults, Jewish cults, Christian cults, Buddhist cults, Hindu cults, atheist cults, etc. You get the picture. It's so the focus of my work is really on the undue influence piece, the social psychology and the use of hypnotic methods to render people into a state of dependency and obedience. And if I'm talking too fast, tell me and I'll slow down. And if I use a term you don't understand, please ask. My thesis is that mind control, indoctrination, what used to be called brainwashing, undue influence is the term I prefer to use now because it's a legal term. And I want to get away from the misuse of terminology of brainwashing. But undue influence is a very specific animal. And lost my train of thought.
Specific theme?
Yes, a specific theme. Yeah, How embarrassing. Jesus. Anybody listening?
It's
okay, well, I'll survive. So the theme or the thesis is that what mind control does is it doesn't erase the person. Like the Chinese terms for brainwashing was a metaphor of a blackboard with writing on it, and you wash the blackboard. It's more of a dissociative disorder. In other words, it's a splitting of the self. And my theory is, again, using myself and my clients as kind of a window into this phenomenon, that what mind control cults are doing is they're tapping into child ego states or child parts and accessing them and redirecting them to the new surrogate parent figures, the cult leaders, etc. And that this new cult identity is in the image of the cult leader, and that this cult identity has many different techniques at its hands to keep the person self-suppressed. But the good news is it doesn't erase the person's core self. And so my methodology for helping people to get out of these groups, even after 60 years or 70 years of involvement, is a bi-directional process or a bi-level process of both empowering the authentic self and disempowering the cult self. And what I'm advocating is an ethical influence technique or series of interventions or interventions to help empower the self. And you wanted to ask something?
Oh, only, did you see differences between people who are born in cults, like Satanistic cults or something? Like,
great question.
Between the ones who are later?
Yes, there's a lot of difference, as you can imagine. For myself, I was recruited when I was 19. And I was fortunate to be rescued by my family after 2.5 years. I almost died in a van crash due to sleep exhaustion, so I came very close to dying. But that enabled me to be in a hospital, sleeping away from the group, which one I called my sister, who I loved and was always very close with. And she basically convinced me to come visit my nephew that had been born and I hadn't seen yet. And she didn't criticize the group, and I made her promise not to tell my parents and my oldest sister because they were satanic. And fortunately, she broke her word, and she did tell them, and they mounted an intervention with me. And I know I just went on another tangent. So back to, I was recruited at 19, so I had a very healthy sense of self. I had skipped eighth grade, I was an extra honor student, I had bicycle crossed the United States when I was 16, I wrote poetry, hundreds of poems, etc. And I had a strong community. My family lived in the same house for 55 years, and good friends. So I had a real identity to come back to. In fact, my next door neighbor baked me cookies when I got home, which was blew me away. I get emotional thinking about it now, 36 years later. But for people who are born into cults, all I can say is I believe there's an authentic self that we're born with. That even if we're in a dysfunctional family system that doesn't allow us to be our real selves, but we develop a false self in that family system, the core self still wants real love, truth, honesty, intimacy, meaning, community, all the good stuff. So what's different about working with people born into cults is that they're often leaving their entire social network behind, including mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, and in many cases they need to be taught what history was, like they need to be taught what science is, but some of the most egregious client or cases that I've dealt with was a group called the Fundamentalist Latter-day Saints. Have you ever heard of them? Warren Jeffs These are people who say the Mormon church went satanic when they abolished polygamy. They're going to do it the right way, and so they're going to marry off 12-year-old girls to 65-year-old men. Kick out the boys, because there are more girls needed for the hierarchy. In any case, people coming out of that group, they have no clue about that science exists, that the dinosaurs actually live, that we actually landed on the moon and gone beyond. And so for them, it's a much more long-term feature, and I can get into the therapeutic techniques that I use with people who are born into cults versus, but it's always, initially, it's always about safety. And, you know, are they, do they have a safe place now? Are they in touch with the group? Because if they're in touch with the family members and the group members, they're going to constantly be guilt-tripped and fear-tripped. So that's going to undermine any progress. Are they sleeping? Are they eating? Etc. I mean, real core basic kinds of things first. And naturally, it helps a lot to network with ex-members of the group you are in, to kind of have a role model that there's life after group. And that all of the phobias that they install, that if you leave the group, you're going to go insane, or if you leave the group, your plane's going to fall out of the sky, or you're going to get cancer, or whatever, that people can leave and be happy and be healthy and live a life. And in terms of religious cults, have some spirituality that's healthy as well. Yes?
How long were you ruling?
I was in 2.5 years. Yeah.
And what do you think about the influence of the group today?
What do I think about the influence of the Moonies today? Well, the leader just died in September at the age of 92. People asked me, how did you feel when he died? And my first honest response was, I liked it better when he was alive and senile and making a fool of himself. But now that it's been a few weeks, I actually like that he's dead, because his children, who were supposed to be perfect and sinless in his entourage and in his to run the theocratic world society, are basically fighting amongst each other. The daughter had a child with someone who wasn't her husband. Another one suing the parent, the mother. So it's great. Very happy. Of course, I'm very worried about the people who are still brainwashed and whose entire world is believing in this man and this belief system called the Divine Principle. It was actually a Bible, a book. I used to teach it. And it's very interesting, because what's happening is with some of the bigger cults like Scientology, there's big issues going on there, because the number two man and number three man left and are talking out against the number one man. And Katie Holmes just left Tom Cruise, and the Master movie just came out, which was about L. Ron Hubbard in the 50s. And I guess you've heard of a group called Anonymous, which is a group of computer hackers who basically created a social movement which brought out protesters, 10,000 on the first day. And because they were wearing masks, all of the ex-members who were afraid of retaliation and retribution came out and picketed, because a lot of their family is still in the group, or friends are in the group, or children. So it brought a lot of people out of the woodwork, and more people are now writing books, you know, like My Billion-Year Contract by Nancy Mamie, or Blown for Good, Mark Headley. So it's exciting for me. We were talking this morning in a panel about ethical and unethical influence and manipulation, and there were a lot of good points that were made. The most important one, I think, is the overview, which is we're living in an age that's unprecedented. We're so wired, and knowledge, technical knowledge, and information overload is happening at such a rate that there are real people are overwhelmed. Many people are sleep deprived. At least in the United States, the average sleep is 5 hours a night. And we know from science, we need 7 to 9 hours of good sleep a night. And it's one of the major mind control techniques, sleep deprivation. So if we want to think critically and we want to act intelligently and wisely, people need to sleep, and they need to recharge their batteries, and they need to be balanced. And you know, people say, how do you feel about Romney running for president? How do you think I feel? I'm horrified.
Yeah, sure.
Horrified. And I was just in France last week. I was like, I may need to move here for 4 years if the election doesn't go well. Because I'm writing on behalf of ex-Mormons who are criticizing the Mormon Church and talking about the BITE model, which is the mind control model that I have presented. So it's surreal. And what is this world that we're living in? And so there's a tendency to want to say it's too heavy, but I'm glad you're here. And frankly, I see the issue of influence as, and probably because I'm biased, as the second most important subject after global climate change for the human species. It's like we're either going to decide as a species we want to live and how we're going to live with each other together on one planet, or there's just going to be this polarization as we see happening, black and white, us versus them, good versus evil, wars. And that's cultic thinking. Black and white, us versus them, good versus evil, just extremists. So, so forgive me for pontificating about the state of the world. But for me, I'm wondering why there are 2,300 people in this room wanting to learn about this.
Susanna? You said if there was a word that we don't understand, pontification.
Yeah.
What's new for me?
Oh, it's elucidating, expounding, going on and on about a particular point to bring it to light.
Pontifex, that's the Pope.
Oh, is that the root?
That's right.
Well, so that maybe has a bad association in the text. So let me take back pontificate and just say expound. So what I'd like to, I'm going to scoot forward to just the concept is influence is on a continuum, and constructive healthy is over on this side, and destructive mind control brainwashing is on that side. And just, you can imagine poles where the cluster is on this side, human rights, basically, you know, respect for the individual, respect for free will, respect for the right to read what you want to read, associate with who you want to associate with, getting medical treatment, all the basic things that we all nod and say, of course, we should all do that. Well, the destructive mind control groups don't want people to do that, unfortunately. Let's see if this works. So I added organizations. So organizations can be more healthy or less healthy. And the healthier ones will have checks and balances, have leaders that are accountable and responsible, transparency around money issues. It's very helpful. And on the extreme negative side, it's about cloning, obedience, dependency, fears and phobias, lots of censorship, pressure to think, feel, and behave the right way. And the organization's a pyramid, structured authoritarian, ends justify the means, closed to preserve power. So, one way of thinking about modeling, when you're working with someone who is in a mind control cult, their cult identity has an external locus of control, looking to an authority figure to tell them what to think, feel, and do, or believe system that's external. And what your work is, and I know as therapists at this Congress, it's about really directing the person back to themselves and validating themselves, encouraging them to reclaim their personal power. What do they really feel? What do they really think and such? And so I have something called the BITE model, and there's a handout which is on many of your chairs, and if you don't have them, we have extras. It's also on my website, freedomofmind.com. And I should say that I created the BITE model based on the work of former military intelligence officers in the 50s, who were basically studying Chinese communist thought reform programs. People like Robert J. Lifton, Margaret Singer, Louis Galvin West. And I took their models. I took Leon Festinger, who wrote a theory called cognitive dissonance theory. Some of you may remember that from school. And I basically said there are thoughts, feelings, and behaviors, and if you change any one, the other two will shift to reduce dissonance. And I basically used that as a framework. I added information control. And I basically said, if any person or group is controlling these four overlapping components to make people a new identity that's dependent and obedient, that's the recipe. That's what you want to watch out for. And for most of my clients, even if they've been kicked out of a cult or walked out of a cult, you know that people can get kicked out of a cult, right? And they're going to be most psychiatrically in danger. Because part of the indoctrination is you're in the group, you have a right to live and be spiritual. And if you are out, then you're possessed by demons or you're going to die, etc. So if someone's kicked out of the group, they're often suicidal.
Say that, back up for a moment. If I'm imagining these four points, and you said if, and apply the cognitive dissonance model, if only one or two, or how many are discordant, then the other number shifts?
Skipping ahead to confirming up on it. There it is. Okay. So, I'm sorry, Larry. Say it one more time.
So, how do you, it's a simple number thing. You said a certain number, if a certain number are dissonant, the rest have to shift.
Yeah, we have a tendency to not like conflict, and we want things to fit. And in fact, one of the number one techniques for inducing trance is confusion. And guess what? Being in a cult recruitment experience is all about being surrounded by people who are loving you and smiling at you and using all these weird words. And maybe they're dressed differently or whatever, and you're totally surrounded and overwhelmed for the most part. But they're smiling and they seem so nice. And they don't seem like zombies, they seem like genuine people who are just really sincere. And it's very confusing. So in terms of the BITE model, you don't need to have every single one, but the more you have, the more obvious it is that it's a destructive mind control group. For me, information control, and it's on your handout, by the way, so unless you like to take notes, for my wife, who likes to herself with things. For me, information control is the variable for the quick evaluation. If a group is legitimate, do they tell people up front who they are, what they believe, and what they want from them before they ask them to come to a meeting and recruit them? And in my opinion, if it's a healthy group, an ethical group, especially a religious group, they should tell you, we believe X, Y, and Z. And if it's like Scientology, where they have the bridge to total freedom, and you can't know what the upper levels are unless you've gone up the bridge, and if you find out this information before you're ready, you will die. I mean, that's literally a doctrine. You will die of pneumonia. Anybody want to die of pneumonia? I can tell you one of the upper level doctrines. You're going to die, actually. So does everybody know about Xenu and the galactic dictatorship? X-E-N-U, Xenu. It's a galactic dictator 75 million years ago. You didn't know that. Scientology, yeah, this is the called OT3. This is one of their secret doctrines. And basically, I'll tell it to you, yeah, be still my heart. Trust me, it's a big, really? People believe that? So he said, 75 million years ago, a galactic dictator named Xenu is trying to solve the overpopulation problem in the galaxy. So he rounded up millions of beings, put them in spaceships that looked like DC-8s without propellers. Of course, when he wrote this, DC-8s were the plane of choice. Flew them to the planet Tigiak, now known as Earth, put them in volcanoes, and detonated hydrogen bombs. Back then, hydrogen bomb was the bomb of choice. Of course, they haven't made them since the 50s. And exteriorized all of these alien beings, and all these alien beings are now on our bodies, and we need Scientology tech to get rid of these body things who possess us. So, some friends of mine who left Scientology posted that on the internet, the actual documents, and they got arrested for copyright infringement by Scientology. Did you want to say something?
They don't give a handout about that.
They don't give a handout. No. It's a secret doctrine. These guys, the police came to their homes, took their computers away, they had to go to court, they were found guilty of copyright infringement, and their argument was, we're not selling it to make money, we just wanted to warn people to know what the hell this is all about. But they lost, and Scientology's intention was to keep the information off the internet so that people would be in darkness and people would be in secrecy. What they didn't count on was the people in the Netherlands were like, and they put up all the documents with the court seal that it was from the Scientology trial. That is really their documents on the internet. And you don't have to spend $100,000 or $300,000 to know that. Anyway, back to information control. There's a big error that people make when thinking about individuals who get recruited into cults, and it comes from social psychology and what's known as the fundamental attribution error. Has anyone heard of that? A couple of head nods, so I'll assume that I'll explain it. So the fundamental attribution error is the single most important principle of social psychology. And what it says is that we have a bias when we are trying to explain human behavior to overestimating individual personal variables and underestimating social environmental variables. So why did Steve get in the Moonies? He must have been weak, he must have not had been childhood, he was unhappy, he was lonely, he was this, he was that, as opposed to Steve's girlfriend dumped him, three women flirted with him, and lied, got him to an isolated location, deprived him of sleep, used hypnotic techniques, and brainwashed him. But social psychology says, you know what? As human beings, we're wired to conform to our peer group or whoever's in the room. We're wired, hardwired through our senses. We're hardwired to follow legitimate authority figures and to obey authority figures and commands from authority figures. We're hardwired. Neurologically. And so part of the work that you will need to do if you're working with ex-cult members is you're going to need to learn about social psychology, you're going to need to be able to do some psychoeducation, direct them to websites and books and things to read, because part of the healing is helping the person realize they're not stupid, they're not a bad person for having been in this group, they were just being human. They were just responding to what was happening to them, and because they didn't have a foreknowledge and they weren't aware of what was going on around them, this thing happened to them, and that it's fixable, and that it's reversible. So watching videos. There's a lot of really good videos, and I put the name of one of my mentors' sites, heroicimagination.org. So everybody knows Philip Zimbardo. He's one of the top social psychologists. I think Bernard mentioned his Paradox of Time book. Dr. Zimbardo is one of my biggest supporters, and he taught a class at Stanford for 15 years called The Psychology of Mind Control, using two chapters of my first book, Combating Cult Mind Control. Anyway, his latest thing is teaching heroes, like modeling what is heroic behavior. So part of it is having video clips explaining the tendency that, for example, if you're alone in a room and smoke starts coming in from the underneath the door, most people will get up and say, hey, there's smoke coming in, you know, fire or whatever. If there are three people sitting there and the other two don't respond to the smoke, almost nobody gets up and complains. It's just social psychology. It's just how we're wired. So there's a lot of little video clips that are phenomenally entertaining and educational. The Ash conformity study, the Milgram obedience study, the one with the electric shocks, where the person electrocutes another human being in less than an hour because somebody in a lab coat orders them to. You must continue. The experiment's very important. You have no other choice. Let me out of here, let me out of here, my heart's bothering me, oh man, sounds like pain in there. You must continue. Two-thirds, continue. Human nature. Huh? That's Stanley Milgram, right. So educating yourselves and also, in a sense, thinking back over your life history. Maybe you were in a fraternity, maybe you had a controlling mother-in-law or family of origin or something, to pull your own life experience about, to normalize the fact that this person was responding normally to an abnormal set of variables. That thing is absolutely huge. What else do I want to talk to you about? So I have, I'm just, go ahead.
I think one of the main problems is you want to free the people in mind who are in the book, and they don't want this freedom.
Okay, so the question is how to help people who are fanatically involved still. And that is 60% of my work right now is helping families who or brother or best friends or husbands or wives rescue a loved one who's been taken in by one of these totalistic groups. How many people in the room are interested in me presenting about my methodology for doing that? So,
yes.
Yes. Okay, great.
Well, I said it's to my husband, it's the ego state therapy. That's a weird, I know it, so, but I'm very interested to listen to it again.
Ego state therapy?
No, it's, I'm sorry.
So, let me just take a couple more minutes to summarize a few things about working with who you're probably going to be working with first, and then we'll go into that. How are we doing on time? When do we take a break for 10 minutes? An hour? About a half an hour?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So I have a client right now. She's a nurse. She was in a Bible cult for 15 years, left 10 years ago. She's had 10 hospitalizations, cuts herself, suicided, tried to suicide 8 times. She has a psychiatrist, a DBT therapist, and a regular therapist. And when she first contacted me, I said, let me talk to your psychiatrist. And the first thing the psychiatrist said was, I've never seen anyone like this woman before. She's the most functional and the least functional person I've ever met in my life. And I was like, this is interesting. And she presents as someone who has a tormentor who wants to kill her, wants her to die. especially at night when she wants to go to sleep, strong urges to hurt herself and kill herself. And it didn't dawn on anyone to ask anything about the 15-year cult involvement and the possibility that she was indoctrinated to believe that if she left the group, she was leaving God, was going to be possessed by Satan, and, you know, that there was a high risk of suicidality, because when you're programmed to believe you have to be in the church or else, that's what you're programmed to believe. So I'm just mentioning it because the three highly competent therapists who just had their blinders on or something, they just didn't do an adequate history and didn't bother to do their homework. And I, as far as I understand, when we have clients with in an area that we're not familiar with, we're ethically bound to either make a referral or get supervision. But it didn't enter their consciousness that her problems were cult-related at all. So I'm mentioning it just because I went to the program on obsessive-compulsive disorders by Giorgio, and so I was so impressed with what he was talking about, and I just started looking through, and he talks about a cult member that he did therapy with. Not my way of therapy, but it apparently worked, so that was interesting. So people are going to be presenting depression, anxiety disorders, panic disorders, sleep disorders, sex disorders, addictions, the whole range, PTSD symptoms in some cases. But are not conscious that it's because of their involvement. And there's this identity confusion and belief confusion and reality confusion. And it's interesting, but almost all of my clients don't wear watches. That's one of my first interventions, is tell them to buy a watch with a day and a date. And to be in the here and now in their body. That's their job. Whenever they're spacing out, come back to the body, come back to the breath, come back to the here and now. And then I want them to make a detailed history of how they got into the group, how they left the group, key points. With some groups, it's phenomenally beneficial to have them write a journal or a diary or something, you know, to do a narrative. Some groups, they have panic attacks because the cult made them do journals, and then read the journals and used it to manipulate them. So again, you have to just keep bringing it back to, hey, there's a whole toolbox of possibilities to help you. It's all about empowering you to recover from what was done to your mind. So the cure to destructive mind control is for you to learn to control your own mind, to know who you are, be yourself. And so the last thing I want to do is tell them how to think, how to feel, how to behave. So I'm like, no, you're in charge. I'll be a coach, I'll be a guide, I'll tell you stories about what worked for me, I'll tell you about other clients, but you would need to tell me what's going to work for you.
Get to this later if you're going to get to it later. I don't mean to interrupt the flow, but I'm just imagining, even doing that, I could imagine somebody saying, that's how you're trying to manipulate me. That they said you would try to do that.
No.
Why doesn't that happen?
No, they actually complain. Just tell me what to do, please.
So why
in some cases, I need to initially, with a clear expectation that it's going to be graduated less and less.
So they don't have enough ego strength to even accuse you?
Usually people are... if they've heard of me in their cult, they're so afraid of me to even come to see me is after they've read my books, after they've looked at my videos, you know, so they've already gone a certain distance, because I am really the devil to a lot of groups, I'm proud to say. And with Scientologists, you all are devils. You know, they have phobias deliberately implanted that you are all evil, 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 and you're going to rape them and torture them and lobotomize them and electroconvulsive shock therapy them. they literally can't imagine seeing a therapist and having a positive experience. And at the moment they can, they're on their way out, for sure. What else do I want to share with you? Just being there, listening to the story, asking them to go back to the beginning, and tell me how you first heard about the group, or tell me what's your first recollection. And bringing them back really slowly, and here's another mistake mental health professionals typically make when they're working with ex-members, is they tend to go right back for early childhood family of origin issues instead of like dealing with them in the here and now, and especially if you identify that they were in a group, you don't want to do the early stuff, because anyway you're not going to get an honest report, because everything's going to be negative from their experience in the group. But you want to go back to when, just before they met the group, ask the person to tell you about themselves and what they like to do, what their favorite things to do, their favorite geographical places, their favorite people, and really help them reconnect to their real self. Tell me, what were you doing? And for me, it was like remembering back just before I dropped out of college when I got recruited, I had written a paper for a political science class criticizing education in the United States. And I started with a quote from Nietzsche that said, "The surest way society could corrupt its youth is to teach them to value those who think alike more than those who think differently." And my paper was about how the educational system was indoctrinating conformity and mediocrity and not encouraging uniqueness and creativity. That was really interesting reading that paper again. Because in the Moonies, we all dressed the right way, we said things in the right way, everything was totally prescribed. In fact, I was asked to throw out my poetry as one of my initiation procedures, was to demonstrate my faith in God by throwing out my poetry. Why? Because it represented me, the old me, the satanic me. Yeah, I threw it in a garbage can. Yeah, I really did. And people who were professional musicians would get rid of their instruments, people would throw out their artwork. I mean, this is part of it. People would be instructed to go home and get all their photographs and burn them as part of the identity restructuring that the cult would want to do. But bringing people back really slow into, tell me about this first few moments, and who did you meet, and what were you thinking, or what was one of your first feelings and such. It's very interesting, because I'd say 80 to 90% of the people, when I ask them that question, and there's good rapport, and they're back there, they will always report, "I thought it was a cult," or "I thought it was, they were crazy," or "I thought this was really childish," or "I thought this was really weird." And part of the social pressures force them to not listen to themselves. And that experience creates then the foundation of, here they are in your office, they don't trust themselves, and they don't trust anybody else. Right? So part of the psychoeducation about influence, that they were just being human, they were just responding to hypnotic techniques, etc., and that they were just doing the best they could at the moment with what they understood, what their knowledge was, what their experience was. And here's the technique. Asking them to go back in time, be in their body, knowing what they know now, that it is a cult, that it is bad, what would you have said and done differently? And often you have to ask it several times, because they get sucked back into the cult, you know, the cult identity, or what is going to become the cult identity. It's like, no, what would you, if you knew that, you know, you were going to watch your best friend die from lack of a blood transfusion by going into the Jehovah's Witnesses. If you could go back to that moment, what would you say and do differently? Tell them to fucking get out of there. Tell them to drop dead, or this is not what God wants, or whatever. And with the power and emotion, it's like, that's right. That's what you would have wanted to say or do. And always it's exiting, not just saying, but asserting. I'll share a very personal thing with you, and this was something that took me years after I got out of the Moonies to deal with. So I mentioned that I'm Jewish, educated about the Holocaust. I know I'm in Germany, and everyone's sensitive to that. And I was made a leader in the Moonies. I had a position in the Moonies. I was told to think about what country I wanted to run when we took over the world. And there was an incident with Moon where he extemporaneously or spontaneously said, when we take power in America, we're going to amend the Constitution and make it a capital offense for people to have sex with people other than those assigned to them by the church. If these people can't hold back their sexual impulses, we'll be doing a favor by taking their physical bodies away from them. And I went, yes, Father. And I was out of the group for years, and that scene haunted me. Until I got to go back and say, you're crazy. You are as bad as Hitler, or worse, and you're nuts, and I'm out of here. And let's get out of here, all of us. You want to kill people because they're having sex with their wives or their husbands because they're not married in a mass wedding by you? You're nuts. You're not kidding. It was so liberating. Even though I knew he was a cult leader, I was writing books about cults and mind control, I still had I want to use a metaphor of like some type of vampiric, entity, not to use a Scientology term, but this thing that was still in my subconscious, that was still bothering me. It was so liberating to do that technique. Of course, it was very fulfilling to be on national television and travel around the world and say he's a cult leader. That also, don't want to minimize the benefit of that. Oh, that was what was the noise. I'm running on reserve battery power. That's not a good sign. Would I have thought ahead to bring the power cord? I think I was trusting the battery. It's okay, I can talk. So triggers.
That's going to be for that's not going to be for a MacBook.
Yeah, I need the big block. It's up in my room. Maybe during the break I'll run up and get it. How's that? Smiles in the room. I want to talk about triggers. Triggers. So obviously I was in a cult called the Moonies. And I was out of the group, and people would say, oh, look at the moon. And I would be back in time in the cult, kneeling before the fat Korean businessman who claimed to be the Messiah from the word moon. And it really sucked. So part of what we need to teach our clients, and this works for any clients, even if they're not in a mind control cult, is to identify the visual, auditory, kinesthetic, olfactory, gustatory trigger that brings up a negative state and ask themselves how do they want to respond to that trigger or that association, or how do other people that didn't have your experience respond to that, and basically reprogram your mind. So for me, you know, I said moon and I visualized the moon. Moon, 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 moon. Moon, and then anytime someone said moon, I'd see the moon. And then when I wanted to think of the cult leader, I visualized him small, off to the side, behind bars. At the time, he wasn't a criminal. He later did go to jail. But I just visualized him behind bars, and I called him Mr. Moon, because he's not a reverend, even though he went like this and said, I'm a reverend. So that was the cult leader. And so it's this idea of reclaiming your mind, reclaiming language, and reclaiming your experience. People say, oh, I can't touch a Bible because I was in a Bible cult. Oh, when did you leave? 20 years ago. It's like, don't you think you might want to have the freedom to pick up a Bible and just have a, you know, like, it's a Bible response? And it's terrifying because it has that loaded association. And I just feel like, especially with stuff from the cult, you want to neutralize all that stuff. You don't want to be avoiding, making choices to avoid stimuli. I know people who are avoiding certain types of foods, avoiding yoga, avoiding meditation. There's a lot of people who are in meditation cults, and they love meditation, and they're afraid to meditate because they were in a cult. And they just need to understand that there are other types of meditation, and that they can clean up the experience and learn how to go inside and turn off the voice, etc. I should also say that I'm very careful to honor and respect and redirect people back to who they are, as opposed to telling them what I'm into and so influencing them. But with religious cults, I often encourage people to just read some survey books on the history of religion, you know, learn some scholarship about religion, etc. to get a handle on what do I believe now, and what was good about it, what was bad about it. Which brings up another important point, which is that nobody's cult experience is 100% bad. And it's often something that's very difficult for, you know, to get past the black and whiteness of it, especially with family members. You know, my parents, if I said anything remotely sounding positive about the Moonies, they would freak out. In fact, I'll tell you another quick story. So I had my automobile accident on the 23rd of April. I had my intervention. It was almost a week. I officially said Moon's a liar on May 11th, and my birthday was May 29th. And on May 12th, my family was like, we want to have a birthday party for you. We want to have a birthday party for you. And I was like, I don't want a birthday party. I don't want to see anybody. Just like, leave me alone. Oh, but the family wants to see you. All your friends want to see you. They want to greet you back. I'm like, no. Please, don't do it. And the 29th came along, and the doorbells were ringing, and there was a lot of noise downstairs, and everybody came for a birthday party for me. And I refused to leave my room. And they all panicked that I wanted to go back to the Moonies. And it's like they just didn't get it, that I was ashamed, I was embarrassed, I was not ready to see people. And that, you know, they asked my opinion, I gave it to them, I don't want a birthday party, and they didn't listen to me. And everybody was upset, and I was upset, and it was like for no reason other than my family just hadn't been given good advice. That, you know what, it's a very traumatic event to come out of something that you believed 100%, so that you know, literally poured your heart and soul into, and then realize that it was a lie, and that you had been abused, and not only that, but you had abused others to get them into the group. It was horrifying. And so working with asking to talk to family members and friends and trying to make sure they get educated and kind of teaching them what they can say to be supportive. And I'll tell you another quick story. I hope that they're helpful. My parents were told that because I'm a former cult member, I'm going to have trouble making decisions. And so... My father said, what do you want for dinner? I said, I'd like a steak, baked potato, and green beans. And he got really confused because he was told that I was supposed to have trouble making decisions, and that seemed as clear as I had always been. But what he didn't take into account was I was a leader in the group, and I decided what not only I ate, but what everybody else ate on my team. But because he didn't understand the mindset of who I was or what it was all about. Later, you know, I was asked by other families to help their loved ones get out of the moonies, and my family was like, don't do it. Just, you know, you move on with your life. Move on with your life. And I was like, wait a minute, didn't you tell me you did the intervention because you wanted me to think for myself and you wanted me to be in control of my life, and now people are asking for my help and you're telling me I can't do that? No? Yeah. Just trust us. Move on. And it was too uncomfortable for them, and they were worried that they need the group and kill me or something, and I think there was some reason to worry. But again, thankfully, my parents, because I'm a strong personality, you know, didn't kick me out of the house and didn't impose their will on me. But it was not an easy coming out process, which is going to be a segue maybe after our break for how I work with family and friends ahead of time, educate them, orient them, and put together a team approach for how to influence the person to come in.
I think I just want to say this to hear how you resonate, but it's kind of an epiphany for me is that from a developmental perspective, families desire, the family's hardwired, parents' hardwired protective impulses in this setting are potentially re-traumatizing to protect you and therefore be authoritarian. Would deny the rediscovery of yourself.
Yeah, I wouldn't. Traumatizing is a little too strong, but my father, in particular, could have used language that would have been more respectful of my feelings, and he could have been sharing his feelings and could have framed it in a way where I felt more respected and more sense of free will. But, I mean, I'll tell you another quick story. People love stories. But before the Moonies, my father voted for Richard Nixon to be president. I don't know if you remember Tricky Dicky. But I voted for McGovern, and I would argue with him about what a crook Nixon was and how ridiculous that he supported Nixon. So I get into the Moon cult, and within 6 months, I'm ordered to go with hundreds of Moonies to the Capitol steps to fast for 3 days because God wants Nixon to be president. And I'll call my father up. Dad, you were right. You know, God wants Nixon to be president. My father's like, Steve, you were right. He's a crook. Dad, you don't understand. God wants Nixon to be president. Says, Steve, you're brainwashed. He's a crook. True story, but I've had flipped so totally around, and because he dared to criticize father and the directive, he was branded as evil and satanic, and it was used as a wedge for me not to contact my family anymore, which made it easier for the cult to control me. Yes.
How did you deal with all the guilt stuff? Because you said, I mean, I think they all have some guilt stuff if you're included in such an organization. How do you work with this? Because I think this is very difficult.
So I think you're asking me, how do I help my clients work with the guilt? Is that the question?
I think it's open for you too, how you want to answer.
Wow. Well, guilt is our conscience telling us we did something wrong, or we did something that we shouldn't have done, or we did something to somebody else that we wouldn't have liked to do to ourselves. But for me, the key is people being in the here and now, understanding what happened to them, understanding that they were doing the best they knew how. And even though they may have done things that were awful, like I talked people into leaving their husbands or wives, I talked them into dropping out of college, I talked very poor people into donating money to a multimillionaire for non-existent, you know, programs to help him, you know, be more malevolent in the world. But that exercise that I shared with you of me going back to each one of those moments, saying what I would have wanted to say or doing what I would have wanted to do, is like I repaired myself. I mean, ultimately, it would have been nice to find each person and apologize in person and see if I can do something to make it up to them.
So this exercise, also this topic is handled on.
Yeah, I really think that walking around guilty over things you said or did years ago is a waste of energy.
No, this is clear, but yeah. how, my question was
there's a phenomenal relief when a person realizes that they're not alone, they weren't stupid, they're not a bad person, that other people as smart as them are smarter or in far worse groups than they were. And in fact, it becomes almost funny to hear stories, and I'll tell you how bad my group was, and it normalizes it. And some of the worst things were where people had to kill someone else because they were ordered to and such, and do criminal activities. So for example, the Charles Manson followers, some of them are still in jail. And they, you know, they were given LSD and they were hypnotized. Charlie was a Scientologist, and you know,
they're
not bad people.
I saw that in satanistic cults they try to manipulate children, those that they kill pet animal or something.
Yeah.
To warn them to the.
Yeah, one of the most egregious cults in the world, at least it's a profiled cult you probably have heard of, and maybe not thought of it as a cult, is a group called the Lord's Resistance Army in Uganda. Have you heard about Joseph Kony? This cult leader, they would go into villages and have the child kill their parent or rape the mother in front of the child and make the child soldiers. This particular cult had tens of thousands, and it's a mind control cult, totally. But I mean, people are coming out of that having murdered their family members. You know, how do you live with that without understanding that it wasn't you doing it?
Yes, I think the problem is that you have big shifts in the perspective.
Big
if you are inside and if you are outside, and to sort this out, I think it's very complicated.
Yeah, big shifts, huge shifts. How are we doing? So let's maybe take 10 minutes. I'll run upstairs and get the power cord, and you'll have lots of interesting conversations and think of more interesting questions.
Yes.
And we'll continue. Thanks. I don't see the red light. Is it on?
Yes.
And it says REC in red?
Yes, it does.
Great. That's not on, though. That's
I got to play.
I have to play.
If you play the slideshow, it should show up.
Oh, I see. Oh, so, on the break, I was thinking, hey, this is a hypnosis conference, and I really haven't talked about hypnosis yet. I think I mentioned confusion as the major, major technique that these groups use. I'm technically challenged here. Let's start. We're still in outer space. So did I mention Hubbard was a hypnotist?
Mm-hmm. No.
Hubbard is a hypnotist. Maybe
this
morning.
Right.
So I was just actually in England a few days ago visiting a friend of mine who wrote the best book on Scientology called A Piece of Blue Sky. His name is John Atack, A-T-A-C-K. And he wrote an unpublished paper, it's on the internet, which is called Never Believe a Hypnotist. That's a quote from L. Ron Hubbard, and proceeds to basically create a cult using altered states of consciousness in order to deprive people of their free will and to make them into cult members. It was frozen in my computer. I think you plugged it in. Yeah, I think it was just this thing. If we won, you mean to swap? No, I think we're good. Yes, please. I really appreciate it. So let me just start by saying, can we have a little more light? So I was out of the cult for 4 years before I saw a formal hypnotic induction, and my reaction when I heard it was, that seems really familiar. And as I learned more and more, I came to realize that in the Moonies, I had been trained to do hypnosis on followers behaviorally, not through conscious explanation, not through, you know, but just like hang out with the older leaders and, you know, be like them kind of thing. And how are we doing, Mary? So they sat me in lectures, and I would pray to God to please allow the spirit to come in me to teach the divine principle, like the brothers who were on the stage teaching it. And I could pretty much do the lecture in three different personalities. One was a German, one was a Dutchman, one was an American. I could do the whole gestures and the voice tonality and the whole nine yards. And I would talk like this, actually. It was a very different tone of voice, being a movie lecturer.
So which file is it?
It's on the desktop. You should say 9-12. No, not 11, it's 12, sorry. So the atmosphere had to be created, there were members seated throughout the audience of new people, sometimes we sang a song, sometimes a prayer was said. And the prayers weren't normal prayers, they were very hypnotic, manipulative prayers. Heavenly Father, Father, we are your children, Father. I'm exaggerating up to this a little bit, but not much. Please open Johnny's heart because he loves you. He doesn't realize that he doesn't want to be a hypnotherapist. He really wants to be a true missionary, Father. But on and on and on and on. And as I explained with cognitive dissonance theory, it's like, if you stay in the environment and you keep hearing these things, your thoughts and your feelings are going to continue in that direction. Your only option is to exit behavioral cue, run away from this crazy group. And most people are too polite to even get up and walk out, even if they find out that they were deceived into an initial meeting. And I say, hey, if you're, you know, especially when I talk to high schoolers or college, if you ever find yourself at a workshop or a Bible study that you didn't know about or whatever, just be really rude and stand up and say, hey, how come nobody told me what this was all about? And they'll kick you out. really fast because they won't want you to pollute the other newcomers. It's really the best strategy. Yes?
You told that you had three different voices or gestures. How did they be implanted to you?
I would sit and watch them for hours.
So it's like...
But I would be praying to God for his spirit to come in to transmit it. So in a sense, I was trans-identifying. I was told explicitly to be like them, and to clone myself, to be just like Jaap van Rossum and Wayne Miller, etc. So there was manipulative prayer, there was this talking voice that I used to use. I'll give you an example of a hypnotic double bind that's used typically at the end of a three-day workshop. It goes something like this. So many of you may be thinking, what if I investigate this and it all turns into a bunch of rubbish? But on the other hand, what if it's true? Could you betray the Son of God? Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we are your lost children, Father. We don't want to close our hearts to you. We don't want our simple minds to shut down the possibility of a world of love. And children have food, and there's no war. Blah, 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 blah. It's very intense. So that's another example. Another example, when I was in the group, I was told that the eyes are the doorway to the soul, and that I should look 3 inches into people's eyes to communicate with them. So if you imagine where my fingers intersect in my skull and look through my eyes at that point, then you can get the moony look. Larry, you've been a good boy.
Yes.
Hello, Larry, last night when I was praying something. But when you have an authority figure and they're all copies of Moon, and he supposedly can read your mind, and he knows everything about your spirit, I believed I could read people's minds. Like, I acted as if I could, and what I wasn't aware of consciously until after I got out and studied brainwashing was there's a pattern that even Mao Zedong's people did called mystical manipulation, where they would basically collect information from other people and then use it with the authority figures without attributing it to where they got that information. So it appears to the manipulated like they're all powerful and all knowing. And it's spooky, but it's very real.
Steve?
Yeah.
Is it mostly young people that are taken into rooms or...
Good question. If you asked me that question in 1980, I would say yes. The average was 18 to 25. But I'd say now it's more the baby boomers, like a lot of the people in this room. People who have gone through one marriage, not so happy with their career, maybe not so happy with the political institutions and religious institutions. What cults want is money, power, and in some cases, sex. So who has the power, who has the money, is not 18-year-olds. They're good for street workers and stuff, unless they're, trust fund babies.
It's understandable why it would be teenagers who would be attracted to it, because they are given a sense of control after a while.
No.
It's
an illusion of control.
Yeah, it's an illusion.
It's no sense of control.
No, but like you said, you could control other people. You could read their minds. You could...
I believed it.
Yeah, you
right?
believed it.
But that wasn't why I became a Mooney, or I mean that was a feature. If you want to be psychoanalytic on me, you could say, well, my father's father was an alcoholic who beat the crap out of my father and never told him he loved him and never hugged him, so my father didn't hug me enough and tell me he loved me enough. And the Mooney sub-leader, who was my main influence, so gave me lots of praise and lots of encouragement, things like that. So if you wanted to say, you know, is there some psychodynamic driver, then I'd say maybe it was a father, the desire to have approval from a father figure. But I think it's really this systematic social influence process that broke me down, built me over, and installed thought-stopping techniques to destroy any reality testing and isolate. Did you want to say something?
Yeah, I rather see that if you should find any kind of intra-psychological factor who are more prone to be subject to the cult,
mm-hmm.
I would think the opposite. Those who are raised very, very safely and in a harmonious family,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because they trust people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, naive. I think that's a very, very good insight. I think that's true. I do have a theory that maybe high hypnotizables are more likely to visualize the kingdom of heaven on earth or whatever. I do think there's situational vulnerabilities, like your girlfriend or boyfriend dumping you, or moving to a new city, state, or country, the Al-Qaeda bombers almost universally are in another country and school or something, or away from their country of origin. Death of a loved one, illness. So these are life cycle things that everybody has to go through. And what turns out is in an hour, you can be inoculated against 90% of cult groups just from hearing a lecture like this. Of cult groups, by just learning about it, by just understanding how they operate and how they manipulate and how they lie and how, you know, you need to not just trust what they say but actually do independent research, and you need to ask specific questions. Who is the leader? What is her credentials? What do you teach? If they say, oh, it's too deep, I can't explain it right now, you say, you know, give me three paragraphs, or, you know, hit the highway, you know. If you can't explain it in three paragraphs, I don't want to know. It's not kosher. The more extreme the claims, the more extreme the proof. And a lot of these organizations, when I was recruited, I said, are you part of some religious group? And they said, no, not at all. And they didn't say, by the way, we bow to an altar with Moon's picture on it every Sunday morning at 5 a.m. So they lied. Lied. Yes?
I'll be talking to a friend tomorrow who is a participant of such a sect.
Uh-huh.
More simple sect, but still.
So this is a friend, not a client?
It's a friend.
Mm-hmm.
It's a friend. But I'm still interested in the influences for change, and I understood it's first isolation that you had in the hospital. It might be the accident itself that may have helped you to doubt in God or whatever?
Definitely not.
No.
Didn't make me doubt God.
I
felt guilty that I allowed Satan to invade me because I fell asleep at the wheel, even though I hadn't slept for 3 days.
So what are the first sentences where you can install some doubt in another person's head?
See, this opens...
What helped you in a normal surrounding, without the accident, without the isolation?
So it really comes, so that's a really good segue to what we discussed we were going to talk about, which is my whole approach to how to help people who are active members of destructive mind control groups. And it's basically what I call the strategic interactive approach. It's based on Ericksonian strategic, you know, family therapy. I wish I could take credit for everything, but no, I just adapted. And
I'd like to get some facts.
Some facts, but let me disabuse you that a fact or some rational piece of data is going to get someone out of a mind control state. It's just not. It's not going to. If they are coming to you with doubts, then I could tell you how to pursue or develop that. But it's really understanding that they got in through a process and they're going to get out through a process. And what I start with is forming a team of family members and friends. I connect them with ex-members. I connect them with other resources that are near where the cult member is living, for example, if they're not living near the family. And we spend 2 days doing an intensive training orientation of what is a cult, what's mind control. I introduce a former member who explains what the belief system is, what the loaded words are of the group, what the beliefs are of the group. And then what we basically do is, I'm like a director of a play that has yet to be written, to try to put myself in the shoes of that person and make guesses about who could say what to me that would move me in the healthier direction. And I basically state where we are now is preparing. Let's say we're at a prep meeting. The goal is to empower them to think for themselves and make their own decisions. It's not to get them out of the cult. Because if you frame it as getting them out of the cult, it creates a control and power frame. It's going to be sabotaging, I guarantee you. Whereas if the family and friends always take the posture of, I love you, I trust you, you're so smart, you're so talented, I just want to know that you're making your own decisions and that you're doing what's healthy for you. And if you believe in God and it's a religious cult, then you can use religious language. God wants us to have free will, and I just want what God wants for you to do. To which they'll say, oh, but God wants me to be in the group. And you can say, I hear you, and I know you believe that. I've yet to be convinced. And what you don't want to do is be oppositional and confrontational. You don't want to be in a frame of win-lose, or I made another point, or like my father, God bless him, he passed away last year, read in the newspaper, Moon had an M16 gun factory. He was like, aha, what kind of messiah has an M16 gun factory? Call me up on the phone, Steve, Moon has an M16 gun factory. I started chanting, crush Satan, crush Satan, crush Satan, glory to heaven, peace on earth. True parents, true parents, true parents. That's what I was trained to do whenever a doubt was coming my way. And all it did, his intention, was drive me deeper into the group and distrust him more. Do you follow the logic of the system? Because if your cult identity does not allow negative information, negative thoughts about the leader, the doctrine, or the group, you're going to block. So the Achilles heel is the following. When you're in one of these groups, you think it's the greatest thing on earth. It's not a cult. You're not brainwashed. But other groups are cults, and other groups do brainwashing, just not yours. So the Achilles heel is learning about a parallel type group, one that you think would be particularly significant to your loved one, learning about it, and finding a former member of it, or engaging the person in a way that paces their experience. And I say to my family, rapport and trust is the foundation of the house. Don't try to build the attic if you haven't poured the foundation yet. So rapport and trust is, I love you, I want to understand you, help me step into your shoes. Not, you're in a cult, get out, or I want to join, somewhere in between. You want to play that card, though, that if it's so good, then maybe you want to know more about it, because maybe you need to reconsider your beliefs or something. You want to play that card, because it builds rapport with the cult identity. Cult identity almost universally wants to recruit you. So after rapport and trust, information gathering. Specifically, you want to ask good questions in a non-confrontational way to elicit information about what the person's thinking and feeling. And you want to match that up with someone who's a former member, because You want to know, are they being 100% cult member? Or are they being 80%? Are they breaking some rules? Because that's significant, because it's not black and white. Every case is different. And once you have those two pieces, then you can go for the what I call freedom of mind techniques. And so one of the freedom of mind techniques is talking about the other group. Another freedom of mind technique is a therapeutic metaphor about people who get stuck and then they need to go to another place and get some new resources and have a new perspective and make new choices. So you can make any types of metaphors about that. You can do the switch perspectives technique, you know, step into my shoes. How would you feel if it was your son? That's what my father did. That's what persuaded me to agree to the intervention. Not because I wanted to leave. I was 100% sure it wasn't a cult and it wasn't brainwashed. But I wanted to prove to him that I wasn't brainwashed. And what he did, which was so extraordinary for him, was he actually cried a little bit when he said, how would you feel if it was your son? Your only son that met a controversial group and dropped out of college, quit his job, and donated his bank account. So my real self was like, oh my God, he loves me. Thought he was wrong, thought he was brainwashed by communists, but it was clear he cared about me. And I did this, stepped out of my shoes, went back 2.5 years, tried to look at it from his point of view. I could see how I would want to do the same thing that you're doing to me right now. It's wrong, but I could see how you'd want to. And then he did the do it for your mother and me. Just agree to listen, hear what they have to say, and then if you want to go back, we'll drive you ourselves, but at least we'll be able to sleep at night knowing we did the responsible thing, knowing that you have the information. I couldn't say no, because I was a true believer. I was that 100% sure that I would never betray father. Little did I understand that brainwashing existed. I had no concept of, because I didn't feel brainwashed. I thought I had a genuine religious experience. So there are these advanced techniques. Chapter 10, hang on one more second. Chapter 10 of the new book is a 3-step phobia intervention that I've come up with. Because phobias are the universal mind control technique that all groups and people use. It's either the utilization of an existing phobia, like I worked with this one woman who had a fear of rats, and she got into a Bible cult and was told that if she ever, you know, left Jesus, that it would be like being trapped in a closet with 10,000 rats for eternity. Literally what they told her. It's like, that would be pretty scary. So the 3-step phobia intervention is basically helping people understand the difference between a legitimate fear and a phobia. A legitimate fear is when there's real danger. Phobia is when there's no clear danger. And then I often give examples. And then I talk about how a phobia is kept in place is basically a negative visual, a negative self-talk, and a holding of breath or shallow breathing. And the cure is a positive visualization. Let's take an elevator phobia. Seeing yourself riding safely and comfortably, imagining, saying to yourself, wow, this is a new elevator. You know, how comfortable and easy it is to go up and down. There's emergency brakes and emergency phone unit. And deep breathing. And then, of course, systematic desensitization. So going through the fact that millions of people have phobias, it's a really fast thing to cure oneself of, and here's how people do it. Then talking about how other groups install phobias in people's minds to control them, right? So one I like to use a lot is Jehovah's Witnesses. Why? Because there are 8 million, and you know, everybody's met one knocking on their door or whatever. The blood transfusion thing, the systematic sexual abuse thing, which is coming to light now. And they predicted the end of the world four times, like in black and white. Last time was 1975, like don't need to plant your crops because we won't be here. So just to get people to say, yup, that's definitely a cult, yup, that's definitely a phobia, that if you leave the witnesses, you can't be with Jesus or you can't be with God, etc., etc. And then get into a third step, which is, do you think it's possible for people to leave your group and be happy and fulfilled? And obviously when you ask the question, you want to give a nice long pause, because you want them to think. And then they'd say, no, not at all. And they'd say, well, but is it, you know, so what if you met somebody who had left your group and was happy and fulfilled? Well, that person doesn't exist. Okay, so I hear you that you don't think they exist, but what if they do? So there's all kinds of like these provocative questions coming from rapport and trust that will then make some shifts. Or this is one of my favorites. Let's say I'm talking to a Moonie. What would you do if Father, meaning Moon, got up on the stage and said, you know, I'm on Prozac now and I realize I'm not the Messiah. You need to go home, get on with your lives. Sorry about that. And Moonies always say, oh, Father, we'd never do that. I know, but what if he did? Would you believe him? Now you got a double bind. What if the Messiah orders you to leave? Or Messiah tells you he's not the Messiah. Now what do you do? So you're getting them to go into that terrain that they could never even conceive of before. Or what if you never met the Moonies and you were happy and fulfilled in your life right now? What would you see yourself doing? Oh, I'm happy to be in the family. I know, but what if the Moonies didn't even exist and you were really happy? And then you hear things, I'd be sailing around the world, I'd be dance performing, I'd be painting pictures, I'd be teaching children in inner schools, etc. But by doing that, you're giving them, you're building other choices. Because remember, in a cult member's mind, there's no life outside of group. It's only a black hole or death torture. I have four pages of the most common phobias I deal with in my work, just to give you. So I organize them in phobias about physical health, psychological health, spiritual life. So just to give you a few. Die painfully, be murdered, or commit suicide, become ill or die, cause your loved ones to become ill and die, be hit by a car, bus, or train, or die in an airplane crash, be beaten or raped, be accosted and robbed, be disfigured, become overweight, become anorexic, become gay, become a drug addict, become a trap. You get the joke, the idea. Or psychological health, if you leave, you go insane, you'll be a deviant, you'll never be happy. You'll be controlled by your past traumas. You'll never get your body thetans off of you. Just joking. So what I really do is empower the family to know how to communicate in effective ways. And a lot of it is teaching them how to be an active listener, how to mirror, how to listen for tonality and body posture. And it's a wonderful motivational device to change everybody in the family because they love the person in the cult. So they're willing to re-examine, the parents are willing to re-examine their relationship and all kinds of wonderful things can come out of it if it's done properly. Yeah.
So they need that psychoeducation that they weren't the cause.
Right.
Well, that's because I can imagine that's the immediate escape.
Thank you, Larry, for saying that. Yeah, the parents start out by, you know, it was my fault. I did something wrong because look what happened to my kid. Because obviously I failed as a parent. And so absolutely. The psychoeducation helps them get off the hook, realize, and introducing them to other parents whose kids have been in cults and have left for them to see, you know what, they're normal, they're just normal, we're just doing the best they could under the circumstances. Yes?
Just a little protest.
Protest.
It's important to not be rigid in your assumptions, because there, of course, there may be some parents who were not normal and who regret how they treated their son or daughter, and
I thank you for that.
Can be in place.
Yeah, absolutely. Good point. Absolutely. So if there's an anger problem, if there's an alcoholism issue, if there's a workaholic issue, that father was never around, I mean, whatever it is, there's lots of room. And what's the most powerful way people can influence another person is through their own life. So if the parent is changing, or if the system is changing, it's going to convey a very powerful message of, wow, things are changing. How interesting. So I hate to call it a game, but in a sense it's like a strategic game, because the cult is very predictable in terms of what they're going to say and do and how they're going to act. So to the extent that you know the script of what their belief system is and what they're going to do, then I don't know about you guys, but I grew up playing chess. But if you understand what each piece's strengths are and weaknesses and where to position them on the board, you're going to get maximum opportunities to impact. And I want to credit my brother-in-law for teaching me complex systems theory 15 years ago, which started this whole thing. Are you familiar with complex systems a little bit? Some one person is nodding. So complex systems is kind of the tool of choice in this complex world for figuring out how to have solutions to things. So we're no longer able to just say A causes B causes C. This is a three-dimensional modeling, computerized kind of approach of microcosmic to macrocosmic, increasing feedback loops and decreasing feedback loops. And the bottom line, if I was going to simplify it, would be that the most powerful thing we can possibly do is create educated agents in the field who can talk to the cult member and coordinate them through information, and not just through what they can say directly to the cult member, but what can be said on the internet, what can be said in the community, what can be done in PR, what can be done with the politicians. So there's a multidimensional aspect to creating a positive effect, and it works. It really works. And why? Because the bottom line is cults don't work. You know, like they make all these promises, they make all these claims, and they just are a destructive mind control slavery thing where people are really being harmed. And if you're in the group for 50 years or 100 years, it's not going to create the kingdom of heaven on earth. It's not going to create sinless people. It's not going to end war and poverty. It's just going to make the wealthy, the leaders wealthier, and harm a lot more people. More questions.
I always wanted to understand whether these leaders believe and what they say. Mm-hmm.
Good question. So the question is, do the leaders believe what they are doing? And it's hard to generalize because there are tens of thousands of cults, but I'd say probably most of them do believe it. And I think most leaders, if we could diagnose them, we'd say they're narcissistic and sociopathic. I would say that at least the major cult leaders have all been shown to have been in a cult themselves, where they learned a lot of the methodology of manipulation, or at the very least a very, you know, dysfunctional controlling family system that was doing a lot of these patterns. So there's a dynamic between the cult leader and the lieutenants and then the followers. And when the cult leader is surrounded by yes people, if anyone criticizes the leader, they're kicked out. So it's the mentally ill get more mentally ill over time. It's a very predictable function. A lot of the big media cults were when Jonestown happened, or Heaven's Gate happened, or the sarin gas cult of Japan, but those groups, for the most part, are the exception to the rule. Most cults are not about wanting to kill their followers. It's more of an expression of the leader's desperation, of the leader's pathology. And yet, family members will look at a Jonestown and their kid is in Scientology and think, oh my God, my son's going to drink cyanide-laced Kool-Aid. And I try to reassure them they're not going to drink cyanide-laced Kool-Aid. If they do sign the billionaire contract, then they may be held against their will behind barbed wire, which we know a number of people who are at this very moment in Scientology. But we do everything possible to keep them from signing that contract in the first place. Other questions? How are we doing on time? Are we almost up? But we are up. Yes?
You mentioned when you talked about yourself that you had a spiritual experience. Mm-hmm. And I'm often thinking about if it's a human need for spiritual experience and we have no cult-free possibility to have this spiritual.
Well, I don't know. I think there's lots of spiritual experiences where people are not in cults, honestly. So remember the continuum I put up? I mean, there are healthier groups and less healthy groups. And the healthier groups, they have, you know, more good things about their membership than bad. Any group that says you have to be obedient and subvert your conscience to conform, I have problems with that kind of an organization, obviously. But I think that it's kind of throwing the baby out with the bathwater to look at destructive religious cults and say all religions are cults, put them all in one box and throw it away. That said, I'm a non-dogmatic type of guy. I like to pray and I like to meditate and I do yoga and I get acupuncture periodically and I'm into alternative kinds of things because I like it. I'll tell a funny quick story. I got a call from a writer about 8 years ago. He said, my editor said I need to interview you for my book. I said, oh, what's the book about? He comes to computers. I said, computers, that's a really, that's weird. What's the title? He said, The Cult of Mac. And I laughed. And I said, well, I'll do the interview, but I have to first disclose that I've only used Apple since 1982, and I have 5 Macs right now. So I'm in a book called The Cult of Mac as a follower. And it's like, okay, although I'm kind of getting turned off by Apple lately. The point is if you're into something, it doesn't make it bad. The point is that you have choice. And, yes?
Yeah, going back to the hypnosis.
Please.
When you were describing briefly some of the techniques used to brainwash someone, to break them down.
Right.
And mentioning things like a confusion technique or maybe kind of a dual induction, things that we may be seeing here being taught.
Yep.
It may come to mind, I'm just curious to know if you have an opinion about whether or not there's certain induction strategies or techniques that just the technique in and of itself crosses the line from more kind of a freedom of mind perspective, or whether or not it's really, it's nothing to do with the technique, it's your overall intent and purpose in the end, or, you know.
Yeah, so, good question. So I guess I want to also mention that some of my clients are victims of psychologists and therapists who are misusing their power and making their clients dependent on them and wanting basically a cash cow for the rest of their lives instead of doing their job, which is empowering people to get on with their lives. And that I talked about in my other program about how if you go on Google and do hypnosis plus sex, you'll literally find hundreds of websites where people are teaching covert Ericksonian hypnotic techniques to basically rape other people. And so it really comes down to a person's integrity, and if you're a therapist and you have training and you have ethical guidelines and you have, you know, boards to be accountable to, there's some mechanisms for checks and balances. But in the world of hypnosis, most people are not mental health professionals. People are reading books and watching DVDs and going to workshops and using these techniques on each other, and it's frightening. It's truly, honestly frightening. And I would basically say that intentionally using covert techniques for one's personal gain, whether it's to get money or sex or to have power over someone, is just evil. It's just wrong. So my posture is I don't do hypnosis work specifically with cult members, and I tell them, you know, that it's, I really, you've been in altered states of consciousness, I understand the states of consciousness, but I want to teach you in the conscious world, what are these techniques, I want to teach you the techniques for you to do on yourself, but the last thing I want to do is put myself in that position. And I know that I'm limiting myself, but I'm also a very public figure, and hypnosis also is not understood by the public, or the public does understand the unethical hypnotists, the Darren Browns of this world. You know about Darren Brown in the UK? No? Go on YouTube. And search for Darren Brown, D-E-R-R-E-N, Brown. He's an entertainer, but he does the impermissible experiments. So he'll walk up to people, do a confusion, handshake induction, confusion technique, anchoring, get the person to give their wallet, their cell phone, their house keys, all asking them for directions. And they film it as a way of just demonstrating it. Or he'll walk into a jewelry store with blank paper the size of money and walk out with thousands of dollars worth of jewelry. You know, but I actually show some of these videos to my clients to show that hypnotic techniques are real and that people can be manipulated relatively quickly and easily. So much more I want to say. So Scientology, in their basic communications course, has a person sit with their feet flat on the ground. Can everybody see if I sit with their feet on the ground, with their hands in their lap, close their eyes, and just be there for a minimum of 20 minutes with the Scientologist deciding whether or not they pass or they flunk. So that's 10 seconds. So they have to do 20 minutes. So if their eyelid flutters or if their knee shakes, they're told flunk, your knee shaked. So that's the first step of Scientology. The next step is sitting opposite a Scientologist, staring into the Scientologist's eyes. That's 10 seconds. Minimum of 20 minutes. And they decide if you pass or fail. The next is called bull baiting, where you have to stare, and the job of the Scientologist is to tell you bad jokes or to distract you or upset you in some way to get a reaction out of you. In other words, you have to be completely dissociated from your environment. Like, what is that, people? What is happening with this cult that is saying they're just teaching people how to communicate, and they're just teaching, you know, they're dehypnotizing people. Hello?
But I think, I mean, the method in the cult is not so, I mean, they use it for special negative tools, But I think it gives.
No, I mean that is one of the earliest courses in Scientology. That also, and then they go up for 2 hours, no blinking. Staring, no blinking. Walk to that wall, touch it, thank you. Turn around, walk to that wall, touch it, thank you. Walk to that wall, touch it, turn around. Walk to that wall, touch it, thank you. For hours. There are body training routines. Well, what is that doing to the rest of us? They're training obedience. They're creating a good, obedient cult identity that does whatever they're told.
Is it possible, these are, in the broadest view, also abilities, you know, abilities to, if not, it's from a foreign person, I mean, if it's not somebody else who's saying you what to do, I mean, if you come in the position to make your own goals, isn't it that the people later, if they're out of the cult, they can use this power for themselves to
sure.
do what they want?
So absolutely right. So I mentioned before that there are positive things that happen when you're in a cult and when you're doing therapy. You don't want to dismiss. You want to actually ask people, what did you learn? You know, even if it's something not directly from the cult, but as a result of it. Like for me, I learned how to public speak in the cult. I was afraid of public audiences, and I learned to get up in front of 1,000 people and speak.
I think it's an incredible amount of self-control what they learn there.
Yeah, I learned how to fast for 7 days with just water. I learned how to exist from 3 hours of sleep for months at a time. I learned how to run a flower business. I learned, and here's the kicker, I tracked down Robert J. Lifton, who wrote the seminal book, Thought Reform and the Psychology of Totalism. He was an Air Force psychiatrist in the 50s studying brainwashing in China. It helped me identify his 8 criteria, that I had been brainwashed. I called him up, I sat in front of him, and I described the Mooney recruitment, the 3-day workshop, the 7-day workshop, the 21-day workshop. And here's this Yale psychiatrist who's written 12 books at the time, and he said, you know, I just studied it secondhand, but you lived it. They did it to you, and you did it to other people. So you should study psychology and explain it to people like me. And there I was, at 22, a college dropout, ashamed and embarrassed, going, oh, I think I've learned something valuable here. You know, it's weird how life can be weird. I learned how to eat sushi in the Moonies, which is still very expensive, but that's when I first ate it. And I really came to appreciate being free. I mean, in a way that most people can never understand. I mean, for the ability to say, you know what? I don't feel like going to work today. Would never be possible in the movies. Or, you know what? I don't need to ask permission to go to the bathroom to anybody. Or if I want to go out on a date with someone, I don't need to ask permission. Or I can touch or kiss a woman. I have 2 older sisters. I grew up with women. Part of the indoctrination was women were evil. All women were trying to rape me. Yeah, so I got out of the group. It took me a year before I could like kiss a woman and not hear the indoctrination in my head.
There were no women in the...
Yeah, there were women. But I wasn't allowed to hug them, kiss them. So they were like, Satan was trying to get to me through women. It was like a constant fear environment. And it was...
Don't they have
these
contradiction having women in the cult on certain positions?
Was it a contradiction? No, I mean, basically, you just need to follow your leader. That was the bottom line. You just did whatever you were told and trust that God is working through the leader. Yeah.
But I'm speaking of contradictions.
Is this helpful? Is this interesting?
Yes. You mentioned, I'm thinking through what you said about strategic planning to get people out of the cult, but, and then you mentioned your father's tears, and the strategic planning I get is pretty much on a cognitive level, but the attachment
and the reverberation of the attachment for years later is emotional. And you talked about going back and kind of what you would say to people, and there was emotion in that. So my question is about, what about the emotional shift? How, what role do you play in that emotional shift?
No, emotions are huge. In fact, so when I was in the Moonies, I was given a model in terms of how to recruit people, of thinkers, feelers, doers, and believers. So if someone was a thinker, you'd approach them very intellectually. If they were a feeler, you'd love on them and be their best friends. And if they were a doer, you'd talk about how the group is making changes in the world. If they were a believer, you'd talk about spiritual experiences. So there was a conscious methodology to identify who the target person was and to engage in a systematic social influence process, bringing in people that you knew the person would relate to, if they were from the same state or they were from the same religious background or whatever, to step by step move them along. So one universal with religious cults, specifically like Bible-esque type cults, is the notion that God is love. So one can explore the idea of, you know, is God give conditional love or unconditional love? Now, if you ask a Mooney, they're going to say, we have unconditional love. But then if you ask them, so how do you feel towards your best friend who just left the Moonies? Well, I feel really sad because they fell away from God and they're really, do you love them? Oh yes, I love them. Yeah, but you're not sounding like you love them. You sound a little angry or a little upset with them that they fell away from God. So there's this whole notion of that even though members believe that they have a higher form of love and it's unconditional, in fact it's conditional love, conditional upon doing what the group tells you to do. And so families and friends take the position I advocate of unconditional love, of loving the person's beingness, and maybe not liking what they're doing necessarily or agreeing with what they're doing, but knowing they're doing it as a good person, believing that it's the right thing to do. And of course with the presupposition that at some point they'll come to realize that what they want to believe it is isn't what it really is. You know, you can believe that the elephant is the horse, but in fact it's an elephant. I'm not sure if I answered your question, Larry, about the emotions, but I can tell you that well-timed emotional outbursts, even angry outbursts, can be very persuasive at the right time and in the right way. People are in there because they can't get out. If you open a few doors and let some light in, people do walk out. I want to tell you a quick story. I was just in France at a counter-cult group. It's actually a European Union called FECRIS, F-E-C-R-I-S. And each country has representatives fighting cult groups. And they met a fellow who was born in the Jehovah's Witnesses. He left it after 60 years. He was an elder. He was an assembly, circuit assembly overseer. And he talked to me about how in 1975 he remembers giving preaching about how the world was coming to an end, you know, in the next 24 hours. He even told me about a woman who had approached him recently, who was there in 75, and who didn't go to sleep that night and was knocking on all of her neighbors' doors to wake them up so that they could be saved too. And how when it didn't happen, he didn't lose a step. He just kept believing and etc. And he furthermore told me that he was an executive with a major American corporation for 30 years, and his job was managing people and critiquing products and like quality control. and how interesting it was that in one part of his life, talk about ego states, mm-hmm. one part of his life he was incredibly functional, able to analyze from many different perspectives, and the other part of his life, zero. And I said, Giorgio, what woke you up? And he said, I got to the point of realizing that the governing body, which is the name of the top people in the cult, that they weren't following the rules.
Quality.
And as soon as I realized they weren't following their own rules that they made everyone else follow, he said, I left within a week. My wife left, my children left, half the congregation left. He said, it was like a light switch went on. And I said, bravo, after 60 years, your entire, everything you knew, all of the people, all in your family, but, and he's the happiest guy. He is so happy to be alive and free. And it's a joy. And I said, you're an inspiration. You know, do more talking. Because a lot of people have the misnotion that, oh, he's in 10 years, he's a goner for life, or so-and-so's in for 20 years, and you know, they're hopeless. And I say, if they're breathing, there's hope. Did you want to ask something before?
I wanted to ask you about the resistance to return to such a group. Your family was in fear, you told us, after your accident. And what do you think about your life? Are you today sure that you will never enter?
That's a very interesting question. I mean, I was in 2.5 years. It's 36 years later. I've heard of people who've got out, but not anyone who studied psychology and mind control. I mean, I read through the Divine Principle. I read through the Bible. I really did my homework. I picked it apart 50 different ways. And I can tell you that for the first 3 months, I was contacted, you know, the group kept trying to contact me, and I knew that I was vulnerable, and I was smart enough to not even meet with them or talk with them, because I was a leader. I knew what they would say, and I knew the power that they had. But there are people who do go back, and there are people who, if they don't understand mind control, are vulnerable to getting into other groups. And I've actually had clients where they go to the next group. And each one is an attempt to heal, you know? But it's such a waste of time and energy, and there's so many wonderful people out there who are afraid of a committed relationship because they don't trust themselves, or they don't trust other people, or they're afraid of spirituality because they got burned, or... yes, another question, and then you...
The 60-year-old guy who allowed himself to doubt the leader who didn't follow the rules. Usually, I understood he would have blocked the...
No, he was a leader. He was just doing what leaders do. Only he flipped it. He took what he was telling all of his followers to do and saying, are they doing what everyone else was? And when he realized they weren't, that would...
Yeah, but usually, I understood you are trained not to... recognize that. And I think on...
Oh, we're not trying to recognize that? I don't understand.
That people are breaking their rules. I think they do all the time, even on the lower levels of training, they break their rules.
Right, but supposedly the people closest to God, Jehovah God, are doing the rules perfectly, supposedly. At least that's the model. The higher up it is, the more pure you are, supposedly.
Bring over my point.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I think perhaps you mean that normally the people try to reduce the theory of fasting or cognitive dissonance. Yeah. If you see that something doesn't work like it is said in the rules, so you try to form it a bit more in your brain.
Yeah, usually
so
what happens is you...
So you don't have to go, so you can stay. Perhaps it's that.
Right. The point, I guess, I want to say to you is that there are really big differences between someone born in a group versus someone who's recruited, and there's really big differences in someone who's really high up in a group. Like, I was high up in the group, even though I was only in for 2 years. I had a level of perspective and experience that most people didn't have. If someone had talked with me in a way that was curious yet concerned and just wondering, how do I feel about this or what do I think about that, I could have gotten out without having to fall asleep at the wheel of a van and almost die and have an intervention. But my family didn't know what to do. They were afraid to go and visit me, and they should have gone and visited me, and they should have made cookies to give to the other cult members, and they should have presented themselves as not a threat to the group.
I mean, you knew your leader had broken rules with his gun factory.
No, I didn't think so. I didn't know that I even believed that he had an M16 gun factory, even though it was written in the Washington Post, because Satan controlled the
So what's different from you about, but this guy had been in for 60 years, so how come he would dare doubt that?
Yeah,
that's your question.
My point.
How come he was it because he didn't call the control?
Think something shifted one day, and I didn't talk with him.
His authentic self poked through.
Yeah.
You know, it could have been a question his mind at the beginning in 1975.
Yeah.
It just took a while to...
Yeah.
Yeah, and keep in mind that the more contact a cult member has with normal people, the better the odds. And he was interacting with a lot of business people, and he was not, he was keeping it pretty segmented. He wasn't recruiting his, employees because it would have been a problem. But the bottom line is that the person is your biggest ally. If you can just make rapport and trust and ask questions, they'll tell you what they need to leave. I'll tell you the straw that broke my camel's back during the intervention wasn't them saying that I was in a cult or that I was brainwashed. In fact, they were telling me horror stories by the third, fourth day, and I was going, oh, you think that's bad? I got much better stories than that. So something was percolating underneath the surface, but I still, on the fourth day, they were showing me parallels with Hitler, going after that one with me, and I said, I don't care if Moon is like Hitler. I've chosen to follow him, and I'll follow him to the end. Literally said that, and in that way, but a chill went down my spine. And then the straw that broke the camel's back, they handed me one of Moon's speeches published by the group, and they said, Steve, read this. Tell me what you think. And I read it. It was a speech published by the group of Moon to congressmen and senators, and he was saying, there's a controversy that I'm brainwashing American youth. Do you really think Americans are that foolish to be brainwashed by me, Reverend Moon, a Korean? I know your answer is no. My answer is no, too. I respect Americans very much. They would never be so foolish. And I thought, what a snake. That was the first thought. What a liar. I had heard him no less than 100 times talk about what assholes Americans were, what idiots we were, how the Koreans were the master race. But it was his words in that context. It was just like the tipping point. And it felt like a house of cards going in my head. And another feeling I felt was like I was at the top of a skyscraper and I was falling off. It was a sensation of losing all connection to, being alive and what was I going to believe and who am I and what's real. And then another one, almost simultaneously, of like being in a dark room and someone opening the Venetian blinds and light coming in and going, oh, it's not dark. It's actually, there's light. And I cried for 3 hours. I needed a wet, cold compress. It hurt so much. Seriously. And one of the really helpful things, and this is a technique, is to play music that has positive associations with your pre-cult identity. It's soothing and connective in the background.
That gets at the emotional emotion piece. That's really important.
Yeah, well, as you're asking me, I'm remembering pieces of all this. To be honest, when I'm doing my work, I'm doing it unconsciously mostly. I have to get conscious to teach, but when I'm with people, I'm just, you know, feeling my way. I'm trying to get into their shoes, imagine what they're feeling. I say something, I try to guess where they're at and make predictions. Yes.
I think from an ego state perspective, your parents were also dissolving your associated barrier. Because talking about Moon's talk, reading that aloud.
See, my parents weren't present during it.
So I thought you were reading that in the context.
No, the ex-members who were my deprogrammers had handed that to me.
And that was a different context.
Yeah. Yeah, but it was very surprising. Because I had been so groomed to die on command that I literally almost snapped my father's neck in a moving car rather than betray father, like that level of insanity. So the idea that it could actually leave and start doubting father was so horrifying to me. Did I talk about the Exorcist movie, or did I talk about this morning? So in 1974, the Exorcist movie came out. Do you remember that? About a little girl was possessed by a demon. Moon rented a theater in Manhattan, and 300 Moonies were brought to see that movie, and then we were brought up to his estate, and he said, God made the Exorcist movie. This movie is a prophecy of what happens to you if you leave the Unification Church. Talk about phobia installation. But for me, before the cult, I didn't believe in Satan. I didn't believe in Jesus. I didn't, you know, we had a kind of a concept of a Mashiach, you know, someone who's going to come and bring peace on earth. But for me, I didn't put the Exorcist movie and the piece about phobias for years after I got out of the group when I was studying psychology and going, phobias, that's an interesting one. And then just trying to sort back in my experience. Yes?
So are there people who are doing systematic research about the incongruencies of such leaders to support people who want to go out?
People doing research on incongruencies. So what's happened that's so different than the 70s and 80s and mid 90s is the internet has happened, and there's a real powerful tool for people coming out, who, especially former leaders who feel guilty over what they did in the group, to tell their story and such. So there's a lot of interesting things going on the internet, and the cults are now trying to block the search engines and manipulate Wikipedia and do all kinds of other dirty tricks. But it really is, you know, forces of goodness trying to fight the bad guys who want to take over the world and make us all clones.
It seems only to function if the idealization of the top of the pyramid is untouched.
Yeah, it comes really down to each individual person and what their experience is. I'll tell you a quick story, and then I want to share two journal articles that are significant that will pique you. Your curiosity, I'm sure. So I helped a lot of people get out of this meditation cult that is no more. But part of the trick of the leader was to do a meditation tape that people would have to listen to several times a day, and in it was not just meditation, but also him talking. And in it, he would describe that when people were truly ready to meet their true teacher, and their spiritual eyes would open, and they would see a golden aura around their bodies. And I was asked to meet this young man, Jim, who I basically asked him, so what was it that made you decide to dedicate your life to Rama? And he described the golden light phenomenon. I'm sharing the story because I want to make a teaching point, which is if somebody in a cult tells you about a spiritual experience, never say, no, it's not a spiritual experience, because how do you know? But what I did and what I recommend you do is to consider an alternative hypothesis, which is it's a hypnotic phenomenon that's happening called visual hallucination, which could be a kinesthetic hallucination or any number of other hallucinations. By the way, Mormons have a burning in the chest. That's how they know that they're with God. But in this particular one, it was a golden aura. And I said, well, consider the possibility that you're doing meditation and then there's a hypnotic suggestion that you were going to see the golden light. And then it wasn't hypnosis. I know it wasn't hypnosis. It was a spiritual experience. So I repeated and just said, well, I know that you believe that, and I had experiences in the Moonies too that I thought were spiritual, but then I came to understand how the mind is an amazing thing, and the imagination is an amazing thing, etc. And he more basically said, prove it. And I wasn't stuck at that moment. And so, thinking quickly, I just said, okay, Jim, I want you to meditate the way Rama taught you to meditate. So he started meditating, and I didn't do other ways. I just said, and I want you to go deeper than you've ever gone before. And I don't want you to open your eyes until you're fully ready to see an even brighter light coming from me. So I gave him a double bind. He'd have to keep his eyes closed for the rest of his life or see the bright light. So he opened his eyes. He goes, whoa, that's even brighter than Rama. That's it. I'm out. I gotta get my friends out. And it was fun, and it was great.
And it was based on rapport, because he knew you weren't a spiritual enlightened being.
No, and I said, I'm not. This is just the imagination and power of suggestion, etc. But open-ended suggestions are powerful with this kind of client. So for the family, you know, to offer an open-ended suggestion or even talk about a dream that they had, you know, that you were together hiking in a beautiful mountain together, and it was so such a wonderful feeling, and you were opening up to me, and we were sharing so many deep things. What are they going to say? You know, you had a dream. It was your experience. Or if you say an open-ended suggestion, like, I know you believe this now, but, you know, just promise me that you be true to yourself, and that at some point you decide you want to leave, that you will have the strength to do what you need to do. I know that our door is open and that we're here for you. Yep.
Do you have examples about humor works? Like
humor's
great,
fantastic. Cartoons.
Yeah,
humor's great, and cartoons are great. And South Park did a lot of great spoofs on different cults, and like you can goof on other cults. So, you know, helping people to laugh about other groups is a step in the right direction as well. Art is really wonderful. Dance, if they were a dancer, if you can get them dancing, it's really limitless. But the bottom line is, if there's rapport and you listen to where they're at, and especially if you hear the story about what made them go in, what was the condenser, or what were the steps that made, then you're going to have an indication that that's going to be something similar. So I wanted to barely show this. Let's see if I can get out. So you're familiar with how neuroscience is coming up with all these wild things. Let's see if I can get this open.
You're going to have to turn on your...
I am. Okay. On the display slide?
Yeah.
Color, display. Is this Acer?
Yeah.
You want to come up and help me. So if I can remember properly, what they are saying is one of them came up with, if you take people's belief in free will, if you convince people they don't have free will, it changes the brain. and it makes them, the part of the brain that has volition gets weaker. It's fascinating. And then there's a... You have a man.
No, I've made enough mistakes.
So this is inducing disbelief and free will alters brain correlates, a preconscious motor preparation where the minds we believe in free will are not. It's fascinating. It's really, really interesting. If you want me, I can email you this info. And then there's another. Can we see it? Inducing the feeling of being in control of one's own actions is a strong subjective experience. However, discoveries in neuroscience challenge the validity of this experience and suggest that free will is just an illusion. What would happen if people started to disbelieve in free will? And basically, it changes our brain and makes us less capable of using the part of our brain to make decisions.
There's a reference in that first paragraph to Wagner, who's written a really nice book called The Illusion of Conscious Will.
Uh-huh. And then the other one is, so, and this one was really interesting. The study used functional magnetic resonance imaging to investigate how assumptions about speakers' abilities changed the evoked bold response in secular and Christian participants who received intercessory prayer. We find that recipients' assumptions about senders' charismatic abilities have important effects on their executive network, most notably the Christian participants deactivated the frontal network, assisted upper medial and dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, bilateral, blah, blah, blah. But you doctors know all about that. The bottom line is that they're now showing how these behaviors are impacting the brain in very real ways. Yeah, exactly. So, for me as a former member who, you know, has been saying, but brainwashing really exists, you know, believe me, you know, but mind control really exists. It's like now we're showing that it really exists. There are real changes that are happening. And what's so wonderful is also that the brain repairs itself so fast if you give it a rich, fertile environment. People have, you know, the counseling that they need. They can get over just years and years and years of trauma and problems. And where people used to be isolated with the internet, people can now be on news group discussion boards, do live video chats with each other, and not be so alone anymore. That's a wonderful thing. How are we doing on time? Are we past, or are we?
Done, what,
6:15? Oh, okay, so we have a little more time. Okay, great. I was somehow feeling, okay, yes, you have an answer.
I'm wondering about the connections between this mind control and psychological torture. Do you think these are the same mechanisms and the same, because there's a lot of research of how to help people who have been tortured, and I see some slight difference, but also some things which might be the same, or I'm interested in your opinion about it.
So I have not had a lot of experience with people who've been physically tortured. I've had a lot of experience with psychological torture and emotional torture. I thought you were asking at first about interrogation techniques, like torturing people to get information out of them, but now I understand that wasn't your question.
Most of the time it's not the real aim. They tell that this is the aim, but in fact it's breaking people.
Right. It turns out that there was a, I think it was a Luftwaffe officer who was the most successful interrogator in human history, and there's actually a book written about him called The Interrogator. And apparently the CIA, all the interrogators use it as a manual or whatever, but he didn't torture people, and he had a great way of developing rapport and trust, getting inside people's heads, you know, making alliances with them, using, you know, information to make the person believe they already have that information, a lot of, you know, deception and other kinds of things. But the whole, you know, Bush era, we need to use torture, you know, in Guantanamo Bay, etc., is just a horrible, shame. And something I'm ashamed of as American. And I've been saying since 9/11, at least if not earlier, that, you know, these groups are cults and they shouldn't be treated as, you know, just as criminal organizations that need to be hunted down militarily, but we should use what we know about how cults recruit and indoctrinate people and counter-indoctrinate them. There's actually a group in London called the Quilliam Foundation, composed of former extremist recruiters who are now challenging the extremist Wahhabi narrative. The Wahhabi narrative of needing to do global jihad and that it's okay to blow up, you know, women and children, which is not okay according to the Quran, as I understand, from Muslims. So they're challenging, they're actually going to extremist groups and talking Quran. Let's, you know, reconvince me to join the struggle. If you have the scripture, you know, I'll rejoin it. So they're having a lot of success with that, but they are missing the whole social psychological piece, which, so I've been, you know, making some overtures and saying, hey, if you combine both pieces, because again, it would be easy for someone in an Al-Qaeda-like group to look at the Moonies and say, oh yeah, they're brainwashed. Look, you know, they think this Korean guy is the Messiah and they do mass weddings. I did an interview with a man named Masood Bani Sadr, and he's on my website. He was in an Iranian terrorist group called MEK. The leader of that group helped overthrow the Shah and helped install Khomeini, and then Khomeini didn't want to share power with him, and he went to Iraq. And basically, the U.S. Has been using them to fight the Iran regime. So there's a whole political nasty piece to this particular cult. But there are thousands of people who I've been trained to do assassinations, do suicide bombing, do self-immolations in a political terrorist group. And
also from the CIA, I heard about torture from the CIA, and terrorist acts.
Well, so there's a whole piece of this that I'll share for 2 minutes. But not to distract from our work as healers, which is the ultimate, I think, goal of this workshop. But it turns out that the Moonies were used by the Korean CIA organizing chief for use as a political tool. And it turns out the CIA set up the Korean CIA. So there's a direct line of military political use of a so-called religion. When you consider the fact that Moon owns a newspaper in Washington, D.C. that's never made money in 25 years, it's cost over $2 billion, where's that money coming from? And it's right-wing politics. It's really spooky and weird. So the bottom line for me is that everyone needs to understand about psychology and social psychology and how, you know, think for ourselves and how to read labels and how to make choices and raise our children consciously. But ultimately, there needs to be some major reforms in our political institutions. Like the American system is totally corrupt. I mean, something drastic has to change. I don't know how it's going to happen other than get some new Supreme Court justices in and change the entire electoral college system and other functional.
May I ask you a practical question?
Sure.
you told the question, how do you want to respond to the trigger? So you work with this, but how you install this without hypnosis?
Because I explain how it works, and I encourage them to make the association and do it.
So it stays cognitive.
Yeah, I mean, I think people who are ex-cult members are basically in and out of trance all day long.
They can't
so it's not formal hypnotic trance. It's you don't need. It's just explaining what's going on.
So and then they can do it.
Yeah. I tell them how I did it, I tell them how other people do it, and invite them. And it's really on along the lines of, look, the way to recover from mind control is for you to control your own mind. So how do you want to respond when you see the guru's picture? You know, do you want to have a knee-jerk reaction or needing to run away, or do you want to just, you know, be disgusted and say, you know, he's pathetic?
So they create the new response, and then they train it by themselves, or?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's Pavlovian, really. It's, you know, if you just, you think about what is the response you want to have, and you pair the stimulus with the response, and you run it three times, and for most things it works. Okay. Where this woman that I mentioned before, who had been in the Bible call for 15 years, and was out 10 years, and had bad therapy for all that time, and was in and out of hospitals, it's premature to do that because she has an active part of her mind that still believes she needs to go back to the cult and that she needs, you know, the only way to serve Jesus. So one of the intermediary pieces for her is I want her to meet with some minister friends of mine who can tell her what the Bible actually says versus what the cult taught her. So that part of her that's the believer, and she's the daughter of a minister, I should add, as well. Her sort of pre-cult identity was a believer. We have to redirect the cult identity that it's okay to believe, but just not in what they had been taught all those years back. So there's another psychoeducational piece, but more of a theological basis that needs to happen. And in the meantime, I'm introducing her to other former long-term members who are happy and fulfilled. So she's getting the experience that it isn't just Satan and doom and gloom and wanting to kill herself. Yes.
This is very exciting because it means that you could start developing some imagery, neuroimaging to document what's changing. So reversing this. And there's another, and the orbital frontal circumference is the valuing system, it's the reward system.
Mm.
So you could imagine doing work where showing the triggers turns on positive value, working on them and having it no longer show positive value. So there's some.
Yeah,
some,
no, the whole field, I mean, I wrote in my first book in 1988, that I predict there will be brain imaging software that will show that mind control exists. Well, it still isn't there yet, but we're getting closer.
But the elements exist.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's very exciting.
It's incredibly exciting, and you know, just I what was it 10 years ago that the belief happened that brain cells can be created. Remember how we used to believe that you had a limited number of brain cells and they all died? You know, it's like, oh, but I knew that decades ago because I saw through my practice that people were changing themselves. People were coming out of totalist mind control cults and recreating their identity. Oh, so let's go back to talking. Eric?
One question that comes up, I don't know whether you covered this.
You snuck in, I didn't see
it. I did snuck in, and that's why I'm asking, apologize if the topic has already been covered. But
do
you have any information about children who are being born in cults?
Yeah.
Because they don't have, they can't go out or so.
Yeah, so I talked about how it seems that even children born into cults have an authentic self, that even though the cult self is installed from the very beginning, there's still some inherent wisdom or need for real love and truth and honesty and intimacy. So that, and I told the story of a man who was in Jehovah's Witnesses for 60 years, who, even though he was a top leader and he was also a corporate executive doing very high-level analysis of systems and products and everything else, at one point he just applied the rules to the leadership above him, saw they weren't following the rules, and he walked out, even though he was born in a group and had been told, given phobias, and all of his family and friends were in the group, etc. What we're seeing now are people who were born in cults in their now mid-20s and 30s, and groups like the Children of God. Do you remember the Children of God? The Happy Hookers for Jesus, where the leader was a pedophile, and members were told to have sex with three-year-olds, four-year-olds, group sex, etc. And they're incredibly in bad shape. Major drug issues, and they don't know what's normal, and they're not grounded at all. And for those folks, they're like, they read my book and they'll say, I didn't have a pre-cult self. What do I do? And I say, you have to create who you want to be now, in the here and now, in your body, 2012. And you get to decide what you want to believe. And you get to, you know, and as far as parents, it's like you need to create new parents. Or at least you need to redo the parents that you did have. And in communal cults, they often, kids didn't get to hang out with their parents. So they didn't even have that experience. So they need to create a new interject of a father and a mother who's loving and protective, and they need to learn what's normal. I mentioned a book that I use a lot in my practice by MollyBKoch.com. That's where it's not on Amazon, but she teaches parenting workshops, and it's a great device to teach people what normal is supposed to look like and to create experiences for themselves. And then if they do wind up having children, they kind of reparent themselves through having children. Yes.
Well, I'm asking also from a perspective of the military, of the perspective of child soldiers.
Yeah.
And do
large things. Resistance army
and
such.
And then they get out or so, or mature, and they have to develop a different self-image.
Exactly. Right. So, I mean, healthy role modeling of other defectors, other former members who can share their experiences and their strategies. But the bottom line is that the brain is incredibly fluid, and we really can make remarkable changes in a relatively short amount of time. And so for Jehovah's Witnesses, many of them want to imagine having birthday parties or being able to, pledge allegiance with their classmates if they were public school, like things that we take for granted is like no big deal. But for them, it was a big deal because they grew up feeling isolated from everyone else. They weren't normal. And consequently, in Jehovah's Witnesses, children are not supposed to be children. Scientology, too, they're supposed to be adults. So there's very harsh punishments if they want to play or have fantasy. There's a communal cult called the 12 Tribes with Messianic communities where they literally beat children with a stick if they have any imagination. Like they're not allowed to have dolls or do any fantasy play at all. It's beaten. They're beaten.
CIA is also real big on weeding out people that have evidence of imagination or creativity or thinking.
In as an operative, you mean?
I had some contact with someone who's director for personnel for CIA.
Mm-hmm.
That was one of the first big things that they look for, is if you have creativity, sense of imagination, and thinking, and the CIA didn't want you in those conditions.
That's interesting, because I would imagine that there would probably be some jobs that they would want to recruit people for, but other jobs so that
they
would...
Typically, they want individuals that are very dogmatic, very black and white in their thinking.
Well, just to share, because I already mentioned the CIA set up the Korean CIA, the Korean CIA set up the Moon, and the Moon recruited me. So there's like a direct line there, and I've had former CIA agents who've read my book and said, hey, I was recruited out of college, and one of my professors professors, and let me describe, you know, what you wrote in your book is, was about me, because they're given a new, especially the covert agents are given a new identity, and mind control is real. I have a colleague, Dan Brown. Many of you probably know him from memory trauma treatment and the law, and he's been evaluating Sirhan for, I don't know, 15 years, and he's has irrefutable proof that Sirhan did not kill Bobby Kennedy, and that he was a Manchurian candidate. It was like really, really clear, documentable stuff. Yeah, and he said Sirhan was the most hypnotizable person he'd ever seen in 30,000 evaluations. But the government, the CIA, does not want to say, yeah, mind control exists. And they prefer to have the whole cult mind control issue confusing in the realm of religion. And it really is about influence. Religion is a subtext of this. But it's about influence. And we were talking this morning about culture. What is the big culture? Are we teaching people to be responsible citizens, or are we teaching people to be numb and buy products that they can't afford or whatever? It's like, it's a very sad thing. You know about Edward Bernays, the father of modern PR? He's a nephew of Freud. He was the first person to combine psychological knowledge with marketing and PR. He was hired to get women to smoke cigarettes by the cigarette industry, as one example. Bernays, B-E-R-N-A-Y-S, look him up, he's a very interesting person. So back to us, back to our compassionate healer stance. I want to repeat a few key themes. One is that systematic social influence processes exist. They employ hypnosis, they employ behavior control, information control, thought control, and emotional control. Creates a dissociative identity issue where they have a cult identity that suppresses the real identity. The real identity is still there and is your biggest ally. And for me, with an active member, getting with family members and friends, developing a clear profile of who the person was before, educating them and organizing them to have contact, to have meaningful contact, including just saying, I miss you. You know, I wish you could be here right now, that I can give you a hug. You know, non-ideological. A lot of families make the mistake of trying to argue their loved one out and using logic. It's not going to work. It's going to be counterproductive. Remember my father in the M16 gun factory thing. Worked backwards. It helped the cult have more control over me. If he had said, hey, Steve, I have something I really want to talk to you about, but I'm not sure how to bring it up, I'd say, what, Dad? And you'd say, well, I just read this thing. It's really disturbing. It's in the newspaper. I wonder what you think of it. You know, what is it? Well, in the Washington Post, it says that the, you know, your organization has an M16 gun factory. Have you ever heard of any M16 gun factory? And I would have said, no, we don't have an M16 gun factory. And then he could have said, but it's curious because the Washington Post printed this article. Is it possible that maybe they do and they haven't shared that with you yet? Maybe you can ask somebody. Or something. In other words, not attacking, but just like, help me out here. I'm trying to understand that. How do you feel about this, or whatever? Or, you know, Steve, you said you were going to drop out of school, but just for a year because you wanted to go back later. When are you planning to go back to school? Or, you know, you used to be such an amazing writer. How much time do you have for writing? Would you share one of your recent poems? I didn't write anything in the 2.5 years that I was in. Before the cult, I was reading 3 books a week. Like, I love to read. I didn't read anything for 2.5 years other than the cult stuff. And for him to say, hey, I read a really interesting book that you would have loved, you know, can I send it to you? I still probably wouldn't have been able to read it in the cult, but it would have triggered the real me. So think about that. One of the most overwhelming documentable pieces of research is the importance of sleep on functioning, immune system, on everything else. It's like so well documented. And this is a point that I share with my families, to just say, hey, I don't understand why you're not being encouraged to sleep 7 to 9 hours, because you make such a more effective member. And members would get sick less and be able to do more work. Like, you know, please explain. So there are things to shift the system, either to stabilize the cult identity or empower the real person, that will have effects. And I do want to tell you that, as a generalization, parents are the last people that are going to be effective at getting, you know, getting what we need done, at least in the beginning phases. It's going to be siblings, it's going to be friends. If we know the person's in school, then we can maybe recruit some people from the dormitory to be agents for us. Maybe, you know, if the person is, well, there's a big qualitative difference between someone who's in an isolated ashram, you know, in India versus someone who's, you know, in college or someone who's got a job. But just to have access, points of access and real interactions with normal people. And most, at least religious cults members, want to recruit. So you can play that card, you know, like, I'm open-minded, you know, share with me. Oh, come to a workshop. Well, you know, I like you, Steve. Why don't you explain to me? I would prefer not to be with strangers and go to some workshop. Maybe we can arrange to get together, you know, for an hour, and you'll tell me about your faith or something like that. So it's engaging and connecting and what else do I want to say? So, remember motivational strategies, moving towards a positive or moving away from a negative. People remember that from way back when. So if someone's getting involved because they are afraid that if they don't join, terrible consequences are going to happen to their ancestors and to the planet Earth, like people hopping in transcendental meditation, if they don't get enough people doing yogic flying, the world's going to blow up. So if the person is hopping because they want to keep the world from blowing up, that's a very different motivational strategy than someone who's in TM because they want to be have less stress. You know, with someone like that, teaching them other stress reduction techniques or inviting them to do other meditation techniques would be a better strategy. You're not taking something away, proposing something that might work better. More questions? How are we doing? I feel like we've covered a lot of good stuff so far. 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Drum roll. Someone's got a good question. It's just been percolating. I know it's.
This self-parenting thing you were told is also mainly on the cognitive level?
No, so this is a book for parents, like an advice guide for parents, so the ways to raise your children, like mindful, like you wanna acknowledge your child's uniqueness and you wanna alter your behavior to make the child feel valued and safe, as opposed to getting the child to do what you want just because it's gonna be mean for you. You know, basic kinds of things like that. But it's done in the context of encouraging people to invent new parents.
Yes.
Who are
inner parents. Yes. So it helps people who want to learn self-parenting.
Right. So with many people who are born in cults, they have no clue about what's normal. So in some cases, you have to explain. Like, so for example, child wakes up with a nightmare. you know, their experiences, the parents yell at them, tell them to shut up and go back to sleep. You know, well, what would you want it to happen? Oh, I would have liked them to come in, turn the light on, stroke my back, tell me it was just a nightmare, that I'm safe, bring me cookies. You know, they're creating the new experience for them. And they know intellectually that their parents yelled at them and told them to shut up and go back to sleep, and they cried themselves to sleep hours later. But in this healing, you know, hypnotic visualization, they're giving to themselves what they needed. And it creates a very healthy, anchored groundedness of course, with the help of the therapist, who's a safe authority figure that's encouraging them. This is a hypnotic strategy, but I'm not doing that with former cult members. I'm very careful. I don't do long-term therapy, and I want to, you know, give them a big push. And I should add that I often am doing like a week of intensive therapy with ex-members. Like, people will fly from all over the world. I'll do 6 hours Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday. 3 hours in the morning, 3 hours in the afternoon. And we just go so deep, and, you know, and I'm just giving them a huge toolkit. And it's, you know, revelatory and life-changing. But the goal is for them to then go back to a therapist and, you know, have a life and not just be dependent on me. So, obviously, if they need a tune-up or something here and there, there for them. But it's understood, it's very goal-oriented. And as far as my clients, I have about 6 clients right now who are actively, strategically trying to figure out how to rescue a loved one in a cult. And I typically get the hardest cases, because they don't, if they're not that hard, they don't need me. They can figure it out themselves, read my books or whatever. So I want to thank you all so much for explaining. Bernard, for inviting me again, and I'd love to teach.